Hari Om. Welcome, everyone. My name is Swami Karunananda, and I'm here to share with you some stories and remembrances of my time with my spiritual master, Sri Swami Satchidananda. For 32 years, I had the great good fortune to sit at his feet. I can honestly say that I worshiped and adored there. I struggled and resisted and celebrated and mourned. There were happy times and sad times, countless comings and goings, many ups and downs. But through it all, he remained the same, peaceful, patient, balanced, loving, always ready to forgive and forget, ever there to comfort and guide. When I think back on those days, I can honestly say that there are no words big enough, deep enough, strong enough, or sweet enough to really describe the relationship with one's guru. But I will do my best to give you a feeling of what it was like to be with him, to learn from him, to be trained by him, and to grow under his guidance. There was a feeling amongst many of us, I certainly felt this way, that he was, and I will say is, still with me all the time, watching and observing. I remember at one point he said, "I gave you the name Karunananda, which means bliss of mercy." And he said, "I'm going to have to watch you now all the time, every moment, to see if you are merciful." So that really gave me pause to think and pause before I acted for a long period of time. I recall too once, this was at the San Francisco IYI, I was serving as treasurer. Swami Hamsananda, who was Sister Hamsa then, was serving as executive secretary, and we shared an office. We often chatted as we worked, and one day I looked at her and I said, "Hamsa, I really need a big push to expand and open my capacity to serve. I really need that now." Within a couple of minutes, the phone rings and it's Gurudev on the phone calling from Connecticut. He rarely ever called us in San Francisco. So Hamsa answered the phone, Sister Hamsa, and spoke to him. And he said, "I want to make a change. Let Sister Parvati," that was my name back then, "be the executive director." And he said, "Hamsa, I want you to work full time transcribing all my talks." So it was like he was sitting in the room with us. He heard that sincere aspiration to grow, and he immediately intervened to open a pathway where that could happen. And of course, those transcriptions that Hamsananda did over the years have been invaluable for our learning, production of books in so many ways. So it was an invaluable service. I remember too at that time there were a group of women devotees who shared a house together. I think it was in Brooklyn, somewhere in New York. And what they did was a practice that some of us did at our different centers. We had a photo of Gurudev and we treated it as representative of his presence in our home. And as part of that, we would serve him meals every day. We would serve him a beverage in the morning. We'd bring him some lunch. We'd bring him some dinner. We'd place him in his bed at night. We would wake him in the morning. It was sort of a bhakti yoga approach of serving a form of the divine as if they were a beloved guest or resident in your home. These women were engaged in that practice. They were all very busy. They had very different schedules. And what they didn't schedule was their feeding of Gurudev. So whenever anyone felt like it, they would go in and feed him whatever they felt like feeding him. Well, this progressed for a few weeks, and then they got a call from him. And he said, "Girls, I really appreciate the service, but either make a schedule or please stop. I'm getting indigestion." Letting them know that on some subtle level, he was present and receiving their offering. A year or so ago, I was with one of the children here. He was maybe about 6 years old, and we were just chatting. And all of a sudden, out of the blue, he proclaims, "I really love Gurudev." I said, "Really?" Of course, he had never met him. I said, "Why do you love Gurudev?" And he said, "Because he's with me all the time, and he always protects me." That's not something he could have made up. In my mind, it must have been what he actually experienced. And I'll share one more instance with a child. I was going to do a blessing for a child. Didn't even live at Yogaville, but their parents were devotees of Gurudev. So she didn't know me. I really didn't know her. Beforehand, we were talking. Her sister was there. They were playing, a little rambunctious. Then we all went up to Chidambaram. The family got out of their car. I got out of my car. The child just looked at the building, left her parents and her sister, came over, stood beside me, and took my hand. Absolutely silent, which was amazing in itself. We walked into the building to the altar. I performed the puja and the ceremony. She was absolutely still and 100% focused the whole time. As soon as that was over, she was a regular little kid again. So the subtle presence is there, and it is so powerful. And interestingly, when Gurudev finally departed from this physical level of existence, I was in Virginia, and of course there was so much to do, so many people to serve and comfort, so many ceremonies that had to be conducted. So one really didn't have time to deal with personal loss or grief. But even after that, I never really addressed that. I just continued with my service. He passed in August. It wasn't until January of the following year when I went to the San Francisco IYI for several weeks to conduct programs that I actually experienced the loss, the grief, even more so the beauty and the priceless treasure of having been with him. But where did I have that most deep and tender, intimate experience? Not in Virginia, where I worked more directly with him on an ongoing basis and saw him so much more frequently, but in San Francisco, where I didn't see him very often. But through our practice and our dedicated service, his presence, his comfort, his guidance and support were there every moment, every step, with every breath. There he was. At least once a year he came and visited with us. And of course, we wanted to make the house absolutely immaculate. For those of you who have visited that historic Victorian that has four levels, you know cleaning that place was a major undertaking. And I would say unfailingly, some unforeseen event or disaster would happen to complicate it even further. I can remember three offhand. One, we're all in different areas of the house cleaning, and someone had put up a pressure cooker with beans for our meal. Now, she then got involved cleaning somewhere else and totally forgot about the beans. All of a sudden, we heard this huge explosion. When we ran downstairs, what we saw were beans everywhere. And when I say everywhere, I mean everywhere. Floor, walls, ceiling, curtains, all the jars with our herbs and teas, the next room over, the pantry, covered with beans, all our pots on shelf, covered with beans. So that added about 5 hours to our preparation time. Then there was the time we were steam cleaning all the rugs, and for some reason, they connected the hose in the kitchen and then set it up, the staircase, to the upper attic level, which was our temple. And that's a long distance to go. And at one point, the hose broke loose, and it was literally raining from the top floor down to the kitchen. We were all in such a state, sort of excitement about his coming, and maybe not getting all that much sleep, getting ready all the programs and everything. So people were just coming out with umbrellas, standing there as if they were outside, splashing the water, and finally we were able to restore it all. To share one other time, he's coming the next day, and at 4 a.m., the plumbing breaks. The plumbing in the bathroom literally explodes. What a mess. The person who was in charge of our maintenance had to pull down the drywall to get to the pipes and find a way to sort of jerry-rig it so we could use the bathroom so Gurudev could have his own bathroom and we didn't have to come into his little suite there. So the rest of the night, we had only just gotten to sleep around 2 in the morning. 4 a.m., disaster. The rest of the time, banging, hammering, and whatnot. Interesting thing. You know how they say adversities are blessings in disguise? When we pulled down that drywall, underneath it was the original marble that was installed when that house was built in the early 1900s. I don't know why anyone would have wanted to cover it up. It was beautiful and elegant. So we were able to restore that in the bathroom. But it made for an interesting prelude to Gurudev's visit. So I'll tell you about one of those visits. This is a time when he was coming for his birthday celebration in December, Jayanti. So we had a beautiful puja in the morning at the house. We had an unbelievable, unforgettable evening of offerings at a public venue. It was called the Scottish Rite Auditorium. We were searching for venues all over the city. And when I would speak to the person, I would ask, what is the capacity? When I called that place, they said, the capacity is 770 people. I said, I'll come down and see you now and sign the contract. I knew instantly that was our place, and we used it many times afterwards because the address of the San Francisco IYI was 770 Dolores Street. So it seemed like some sort of divine synchronicity there. So we had this extraordinary program. It was packed. Someone had put together a slideshow. Think of this, a slideshow that was so magnificent and inspiring, celebrating Gurudev's life, celebrating integral yoga, that the end of the slideshow, the whole audience jumped to their feet in a standing ovation. I have never seen that before or since. So afterwards, we had arranged to go for an Indian dinner at Gaylord's restaurant in San Francisco. It was going to be a Lotus fundraising dinner. Many people had signed up. People came from all over California for Jayanti. Actually, they came from all over the country for this event. So we had a big dinner. People came up and greeted Gurudev afterwards, visited with him. It was going on to 2 a.m. when this finally ended, because after the evening event, it wasn't until about 11 o'clock that we began the meal. So we're leaving Gaylord's. There's an elevator to get down to the main level. Gurudev goes in, and then he starts beckoning different specific people to come into the elevator with him. You go, oh, this family, come on in. This family, come in. You come in. Hand picking. And I'm looking with my logical, analytical mind, and I notice the little sign, 12 people maximum occupancy. And I'm thinking, there are over 24 people in there now. And then he invited a few more, including me. And when we were shoulder to shoulder, like literally sardines, he pushed the button, the elevator started moving, and then with a lurch, stopped between floors. And I'm thinking, oh no, we overloaded it. It's 2 a.m. Who's going to be available to help us? Even in that shopping area, it was totally deserted, and you can't easily get a repair person at 2 in the morning on a Saturday night. So some people started making calls all over the city, and then some people stayed on the floor above us. Others went to the floor below us and started praying and chanting and Triambakam mantras, because you didn't know if all of a sudden it was going to drop and crash down. You had no idea what was going on. It began getting very hot and stuffy in there, to say the least. My immediate thought is we should all be as still as possible to conserve oxygen. And as if in response to my thought, Gurudev immediately said, let's all start chanting Rama, 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 Rama. Not only would we be using up a lot of oxygen, but if you know anything about the Rama chant, it's what's called a fire bija, a fire mantra. It increases heat. So I'm going, I don't know what's going on here. My logical mind was beginning to lose its footing in a way, and people started acting out in different ways. Some people were just trying to stay cool on all levels. Others began to panic. Some would jump up every few minutes and start pushing buttons. One person actually got on someone's shoulders and tried to crawl out the top of the compartment. And I'm thinking, he must know what he's doing. I'm sure he's in charge. But still, the mind was thinking, what's going on here? And how is this finally going to play out? So we were in that compartment, as I recall, maybe 40, 45 minutes. And then Gurudev simply leaned over, pushed a button, the elevator started, and we were at ground level, and everyone dispersed. I happened to be in the car with him as we were returning to the institute. And we asked him, Gurudev, what was going on in there? We're stuck. People keep pushing the buttons. There's no response. It doesn't look like there's going to be an easy solution here. And then all of a sudden, you press a button and it moves again. And Gurudev's reply was, well, it's really very simple. God wanted to make a test. When all the data was in and he had all the information he needed, there was not a need for the test to continue even another second. So it was over. My lesson from that is, two lessons actually. There's a higher plan behind everything that unfolds in our life, everything that unfolds in the lives of our loved ones, everything that unfolds in the world. And secondly, with respect to karma, as soon as a karma has been purged, instantly everything can turn around. But a beautiful ending to that story is, so we finally got back to the IYI. It was close to 4 a.m. Some people had returned early to make preparations for Gurudev's return. They were understandably concerned about what had happened and so happy to see him. And they were so happy and joyful. I remember that one person started dancing, and then Gurudev started dancing. And the way he danced, they talk about Lord Nataraja's dance of bliss that he performed for Sri Patanjali at Chidambaram. He started doing all the Nataraj mudras, standing on one leg, Abhayahasta, the have no fear, all this explosion of joyous dancing. And what followed was, he went into our living room, the front room, and sat down. And we all gathered around, sitting down too. And there was perfect stillness. Usually, whenever he was with us, every single solitary moment, we were busy, busy, busy. Doing things, preparing things, organizing things, serving him, even more serving all the guests that came to see him, to have informal satsangs with him. We, the residents and staff, never really had an opportunity to just be with him, just rejoice in his peace and his presence. So there we were. It was 4 a.m. in the morning. No one was going to come to the door. The phone wasn't going to ring. There was nothing to do. We sat there in silence for a few moments, and then he began to sing Tamil lullabies to us. We sat there. Everyone was a little hyped from the day's events, and he just sang lullabies to us. And as everyone became very calm and relaxed, peaceful, we all drifted up to bed. It's just a beautiful, beautiful memory. Many devotees wanted to see Gurudev and wanted to invite him to their homes so he would bless their home and they would have the blessing of being able to feed him. So this is a little story about prasad. So one such person was well noted for being a fantastic Indian cook. And she lived south of San Francisco. And I had the opportunity to drive Gurudev to a special luncheon that she had prepared for him. So we arrived, and it was not only she and her husband there, but all her friends were there, all these women who had also cooked and were there to serve. And I think there's something in the Indian tradition, they feel the more food you eat, the more blessing for them. They graciously invited me to join them for the meal. And then about 10 people were lined up to serve the food. So they went to Gurudev, and maybe there were a couple of other people seated at the table, and then to me, and served everyone all those items. And I looked at the food and I thought, this is more food than I can eat in a week. But I was brave. I knew it was going to be delicious, and I dived in. I thought, okay, I did my duty as a guest. I ate everything that was on my plate. Then they came around with seconds. And of course, Gurudev was accepting, you know, these 10 dishes are coming around, but I was already up to here. So as sweetly and graciously as I could, I said, no, thank you. And as they kept coming around with more things, I realized I couldn't keep saying, no, thank you. I had to accept something. I was, in a way, insulting the host. So I just said in my mind, I don't care what it is. Whatever the next item is, I'll say, okay, thank you, just a little, please. So the next item was rice. And I said, yes, please, thank you. And then all of a sudden they were coming up with all the other dishes. And I said, no, the rice is okay. He said, you can't just eat rice. No one eats just rice. And before my eyes, I saw a mountain of food appear on my plate again. And I was sitting opposite Sri Gurudev. And I looked at him with focused attention. I just stared at him. And in my mind, I said, I will die if I eat all this food. It is impossible for my system to receive any of this food now. And I said, you're going to have to take care of it. You're going to have to take care of it. And I kept my eyes fixed on him. I couldn't even taste what I was eating. I was just doing my duty and politely putting it into my mouth, focused on him the whole time. After the meal, it felt like I hadn't even eaten. There was no digestive process. It just transmuted into a blessing in my system. It like sublimated. In chemistry, you have the term sublimate, when something solid can go to an invisible vapor state. It doesn't even have to go through a liquid transition. So that's what the food did. It went from solid to ethereal. And I experienced that one time before. This was at a retreat in Northern California. I was serving as
the cook.
I started my service at the IYI as the cook of the Berkeley IYI, and then I was asked to be the cook at this retreat. So we had, I don't know, maybe 150 people. I remember that experience. I remember especially cooking the dal. There was a huge cauldron, and I was given an oar to stir it and a ladder to stand on. And I thought, one false move, and I'm part of the sambar. I'm part of the dal. And in my mind, I said, Gurudev, you're going to have to find some other work for me to do. This body isn't big enough to cook for that many people. So anyway, because I cooked the meal, I had the opportunity to serve Gurudev's table. And seated next to him was Sohini Mehta. She was regarded as his first devotee, ardent, devotional, and dynamic woman. Several times over the years, she would come to the ashram in Virginia, go into the kitchen, and just stand there making hundreds of chapatis for all of us, homemade. It was like divine nectar. So anyway, as I was serving, I would put the food on Gurudev's plate. Gurudev, in turn, would take some of that food and put it on Sohini's plate. And then when I got around to serving Sohini, she would take some of that food that he had given her and pop it in my mouth. So in a way, the food was twice blessed. It was blessed by the master, and it was blessed by this pure devotee. That's the first time I ever experienced prasad. It was literally like an explosion, like that, through my whole system. It was divine blessing in the form of food. And I imagine if we had the capacity to always consume our food with that consciousness, realizing its nourishment that came from Mother Nature, blessing from the divine to sustain us in life, if we could really keep that consciousness, we'd probably have that experience on an ongoing basis. Something to think about. Moving along to the Santa Barbara Ashram, 70 acres of a former avocado ranch in Santa Barbara. It was a beautiful location. We purchased it in 1976. Very rustic setting, very different from the very refined environment that we had in San Francisco, but different types of learning experiences happened there. And we were able to get a home for Gurudev in Montecito, the nearby town, a beautiful home where he wintered many years. So part of the time I lived at the ashram, part of the time I served as caretaker at La Paz, which was the name for Gurudev's house. And I still remember setting up for his visits and how playful he was. So one time, the house is all ready for him to come. He goes in, he's inspecting everything, and someone had made him a lotus clock. It was a wooden clock, but it had somehow the different symbols that are in lotus were there instead of numbers. And to my understanding, the clock no longer worked because it stopped showing correct time a while back. So Gurudev asked me, he said, Karunananda, what's wrong with the clock? I said, it's broken, Gurudev. He said, it's broken? I said, yeah, it stopped working. So he picks it up, turns it around, pulls out the batteries. He said, Karunananda, it just needs new batteries. And he was sort of scolding me for not knowing that or something, but the scolding seemed so out of proportion to the incident. And normally when you're with your guru, you try to always be very respectful and calm and receiving of his training and all, but I just burst out hysterical laughing. I thought it was the funniest thing that I hadn't thought of it and that he was making such a big deal of it. Both of those things just struck me as so funny, and I just genuinely couldn't stop laughing. And when he saw that I wasn't going to stop laughing, he joined in and started laughing too. And then his final comment was, Karunananda, they're sending women to the moon today. Please learn something about electricity. So anyway, it was just a fun experience. In Santa Barbara, I'd say Gurudev played with us and he worked with us. I remember going out on a whale watch with him. The captain of the boat told us, "Don't be disappointed. The whales don't always come. We may not see any." As soon as we got out into deep water, we were flanked by mamas and babies who stayed with us for the whole trip, the whole trip. Once we went to the beach, all Gurudev wanted to do was to get on a surfboard. People convinced him not to stand. I think what he did, if I remember correctly, he was kneeling on it. But he went way out and then came in with the waves. He saw a couple of us, myself included, sort of daintily walking along the shoreline, just chatting, not really engaging in the beach experience. So he looked at one of the fellows and he looked at me and he said, "Throw her in." And then he turned to me and he said, "Is it all right? Do I have your permission?" I said, "Yes, Gurudev." And all of a sudden, I'm lifted up, walked way out, dropped into the water. But it made for a memorable experience. Every Saturday morning, we had karma yoga at La Paz, and he would give us different things to do. There were so many different things. He would say things that made you realize what we were doing outwardly was analogous to what the work inwardly was doing, that there wasn't really a separation between inner and outer. And I can remember two instances of that. There was one woman who was having a lot of trouble with her intestines, with her pipes. Gurudev opened the hood of his car. He had these classic old cars and had her cleaning the motor. I've never seen a motor clean that way. Like the motor was sparkling at the end of her shift. And then I saw him go to prune a bougainvillea plant. If you know bougainvilleas, they're very beautiful, colorful plants. And Gurudev took these, like a garden tool, and started chopping away and hacking away at it. And I thought, I was the one watching it. Oh my goodness. And what was left was like this misshapen stump, which very shortly grew into an even more beautiful bush. It was a good lesson. When things are removed, even though sometimes it might look like what's going on here, it's so that something even more beautiful can manifest. One of my experiences with Gurudev and his service in Santa Barbara was he decided he wished for me to oversee all his financial accounts in California. So to do that, he called me to his home one day so that he could train me how to do it. So we were sitting in his living room. One whole side was just glass, windows, doors. And so glass was all over here. He was there and I was sitting here. And he said, "I'm going to train you the way my father trained me." So that in itself was awesome. And he told me a system to keep. And he told me, before you go to sleep every night, every transaction should be entered so that as you go to sleep, you know exactly the status of every account. And he said, the treasury is the eyes of an organization. If you don't know that information, the organization is moving blind. And another interesting thing he said, money should be respected. It is the divine Shakti. It's the goddess circulating throughout society. People do work, people purchase things, they do all sorts of things, but they facilitate all of that by this common medium of exchange. And it carries the energy of God and the energy of our collective consciousness. So anyway, he was giving me this very intensive training, and I felt so blessed to be receiving. And then out of the corner of my eye, as he was talking, I noticed a hummingbird feeding on a beautiful pink hibiscus plant that was growing right next to the glass. So Gurudev's talking, giving me all this very important information, and I start doing a thing like this, and the next thing I know, I'm totally turned. I totally forgot about him. I forgot where I was. I forgot treasury. I was totally enthralled by this beautiful hummingbird and watching it feed on the nectar of that flower. And then I don't know how long I was gazing, probably several minutes, and all of a sudden I heard, as if out of another dimension, must be feeding time. And I snapped back and I went, oh, Gurudev's here. You know? The point here, how he understood and the tenderness of his heart embraced that very precious moment. There was so much tenderness to remember something like that so many years later. Think about him. He had a very tender heart. We once had a Swami visit us here in Virginia. I think he was someone who served in South America, if I'm remembering correctly now. We had never seen him before. He had never been to the ashram before. And he spent a few days with us, with Gurudev, with us and Gurudev. And he gave a final satsang. And he said, you people don't realize how special and unique and unusual your relationship with your guru is. Most gurus, they're on a stage and they're aloof. They keep a respectful distance from people. But he said the love that he experienced moving both ways, guru, disciple, to disciple, all over. He said he's never seen anything like it before. You're not simply gurus and disciples. In the best sense of the word, you're truly a family united by love. So he had that tender heart. He had that tender heart. Once he invited me to come do banking with him in Santa Barbara. Some things had to be done for his accounts. And after we had transacted all the business, he said, are you getting hungry? I could tell he was. So I said, sure. Would you like to eat something? He said, how about some pizza? He liked pizza. So we went to a pizza restaurant in town and we ordered some pizzas. He ordered lots of toppings. And then when the pizza came, he said, I'm going to show you the right way to eat pizza. And what he did was he scraped all the toppings off into the plate and he put the crust on a discard bowl. He said, this way you have room for more of the good stuff. So that's how we had pizza. And as we were there, he noticed that someone at the ashram came in and was having a meal. Of course, they weren't supposed to be in town having a meal at that time. So the stance he could have taken was a little bit of, why are you here? You know. Instead, he watched as the person finished and then he signaled the waitress to come and he said, tell that person that someone else paid his bill. And then Gurudev sat and watched as the waitress communicated that and how excited and surprised the person became. And he loved it. He loved it. Once during this time in Santa Barbara, when I was living at the ashram, one morning I awoke somehow filled with despair at my capacity to realize the truth, to realize that highest, divine, supreme peace and bliss. I just took a frank self-assessment. I looked at myself. Then I thought about becoming the master of all of nature, then transcending nature and experience supreme divine consciousness. And I looked at myself and I said, this doesn't compute. This cannot do that. There's no way I have the capacity to do that. So I became more depressed and I decided to call Gurudev. He was in residence in Montecito at the time. And I called him and I said, Gurudev, you know that the most important thing to me is my spiritual life and attaining that divine realization. I've given my whole life toward that end. When I look at myself honestly, I really don't think I have the capacity. And I'm sobbing at this point. And inside, I'm thinking, he's going to give me sort of like a cheerleader type of talk, you know, a little bit of encouragement, maybe some guidance, some inspiration. So I'm sobbing, feeling so incapable of doing what I had set out to do, looking earnestly for his guidance. And instead, what did I get? Click! He hung up the phone. He hung up on me. So my conclusion was, number one, it must be true. And number two, in his compassion, he didn't want to tell me that. So he chose to be silent rather than tell me the truth. So I had a pretty miserable day. That evening, we were having satsang. We had satsangs then in a local church. Normally at satsang, I would always sit right in the front to the left of Gurudev. I'd always sit there. Normally at satsang, he would go right to a question box where people had submitted questions for him. But tonight, I wasn't there. I was way in the back. I wasn't seated. I was standing there like this. I was not happy, and I was a little angry at him because he didn't comfort me and try to uplift me. So he came in, he sat down. First thing he did was he looked where I'm normally sitting. I'm not there. He begins scanning the room. He sees me in the back, and probably I had little red arrows coming out of my head due to my bad attitude. So I probably was easy to find. So he looked out on the crowd and he said, some of you out there might feel you are not strong enough to realize the higher goal. Some of you might think you don't have the capacity. Well, he said, you're absolutely right. And he pauses. And I'm thinking, what's he doing? It's like rubbing salt in a wound. What's going on here? But he added, you don't have to do it alone. There's a higher power that's always present and ever ready to help you every step of the way. And with the help of that higher power, all things are possible. So after that talk, well, my hands came down. Probably the red arrows disappeared. My aura returned to normal. But I reflected and I thought, you know, there are lots of appliances, lots of toys that can operate on gadget or plug-in. When you operate on gadget, you have a limited capacity. You're repeatedly running down. You're always having to recharge. And there's just so much you can accomplish. But when you plug in, you can draw unlimited energy for whatever needs to be done. I thought, we're like that. Problem is, most of us, most of the time, operate as if we're on battery pack. We feel limited. We run down. We're continually needing to recharge. What we don't realize or what we have forgotten is that there is a universal outlet. We've been equipped with a plug. We can plug in and draw all that we need. During the time I served as caretaker of La Paz, one of my jobs was to take care of Gurudev's dogs. He had two small, I think they were terriers. I don't know, Sita might have been a dachshund. I'm not sure, but they were two small dogs. And he named them Ram and Sita. Gurudev had a dog in Connecticut. He had dogs here. And very often, his dogs weren't very well behaved. I think he enjoyed letting them be mischievous. But anyway, Ram and Sita were very unique. Ram was a little dominant and pushy. Sometimes he would go on sprees and be away all night gallivanting. We don't know where and exactly what he was doing, but what we do know, when he would come back after one of those jaunts, they lived in the laundry room. Sita would block the entrance and not let him in. He had to sleep in the carport. So you could imagine what he had been up to. He had been a little naughty, probably. But anyway, they were so close and devoted. At Gurudev's property, as part of the Karma Yoga that we did on Saturdays, we put in a beautiful interfaith meditation path that sort of meandered through the hills. We had shrines for Jesus, for Buddha, for Shiva, for Mother Mary. And I would sometimes take walks with both of them along those paths. And Rama would always push ahead. He would be first, always. That was his nature. It was his temperament. And Sita was like the obedient, patient wife. She accepted his behavior. Except when we would come to the shrine of the Divine Mother. When we would come, when we'd go, that was on the lower path, when we'd start walking there, Ram would fall back and let Sita take the lead. And there was such a presence about her. When we would go there, I would fall back and let Sita take the lead. And we'd slowly go. She walked more slowly, and we would patiently follow her. You have no idea what I'm saying. Ram patiently following her. And Sita was always very respectful and dainty, but she would jump up onto the meditation bench and sit there gazing at the statue of the mother for however long she wished, at least several minutes, sometimes longer. She was in prayer. She was doing her devotions. And then when she was done, she would come down. We'd continue on our walk. Ram would burst forward, and things would return to normal. So after some time, after they had been together for many years, Sita passed away, and Ram went into profound grief and mourning to the point where he stopped eating. And we were concerned that he was going to pass away. So I called Gurudev and I told him, we're concerned. And somehow Gurudev very soon managed to come to La Paz. He changed his plans in order to do that. And I was in the next room, so I heard his discussion with Ram. Gurudev was sitting in a chair. Ram was sitting right in front of him. And Gurudev said, Ram, you had your sweetie with you for so many years. She was your beloved. She was your devoted companion. You were very blessed. You should be very grateful that God gave you a companion like that. But now God has brought her home to him. And he said, the time has come for you to renounce. Ram, it's time for you to become a renunciate and live the rest of your life in that way. So put aside the grief and the mourning. Be grateful for the presence of Sita in your life all these years, and now you become a renunciate, thinking of God always. And after that, Ram's mood totally changed, and he lived, I don't recall how many years more after. But again, another example of that tender heart, the respect for all life, and the ability to really communicate with all creatures. I mean, Patanjali in the Yoga Sutras tells you, you can have the siddhi of being able to communicate with all different forms of life. My experience, my relationship with the siddhis, so to say, is you don't need to manipulate nature. You don't need to do special things. If the love in your heart is there, that higher power, that divine consciousness will bestow upon you any and all of these powers or gifts when they are useful in the service. We decided to sell the ashram in Santa Barbara in order to consolidate finances and personnel, all our resources, and to make our East Coast center our international headquarters. We had just purchased Yogaville, Virginia, and we were consolidating. So we closed everything down, and then we had to shut down our Connecticut ashram, which was the East Coast center before Virginia, pack that up as well. So myself and a good friend, Bashkar, we were designated as the people to drive one of Gurudev's classic antique Cadillac convertibles from West Coast to the East Coast. Somehow we took the southern route, and it was record-breaking hot temperatures. When you'd open the door, it was literally like you were sticking your head in an oven. It was triple-digit weather every day. So as to be expected, the car began having problems. And Gurudev told us to call him every single day and to sleep during the day and to drive at night when the weather was cooler. Made good sense. And we followed that. And a couple of times we had to stop and have repairs for a couple of days. It was an interesting journey, but every day we spoke to him, and I remembered we'd get on the phone and he'd go, "Are you two still alive out there? Are you still there?" And it was so much fun. The car was bubblegum pink. Imagine a classic Cadillac convertible, bubblegum pink. So it definitely elicited notice as we made our trek cross country. And we even had on several occasions people in new, expensive, modern cars drive up next to us and offer to trade vehicles. It was, the car had that much energy to it. Well, at one point, we were on this deserted highway. We hadn't seen another car in many, many, many miles. The car decided to totally break down. Fortunately, there was an overpass a few hundred yards in front of us, and we were able to coax the car forward so at least we could have some shade. And we both proceeded to collapse in the car. We just collapsed. And we would have no doubt expired there totally had not, out of the blue, out of nowhere, this man drives up in a truck. We hadn't seen anyone. It might have been hours. This man drives up in a truck. He rouses us and wants to take us to his home. Bashkar won't leave the car because it's Gurudev's car. He said, "I'm not going to leave it. If you have a was called a winch or something to hook up and tow us, I'm not leaving." So he collapsed again on the seat. And rather than try to argue with him, this man, a complete stranger, picks me up, puts me in his car, drives off. We get to his home. It's either his wife or his daughter was there. They draw a tub, fill it with cold water, and clothes and all, they pick me up and they put me in the tub. Saved my life. He goes back immediately, hooks up the truck, brings by Bashkar. I don't even think he got out of the car. I think he was just towed in the car. As soon as Bashkar arrived, they picked me up out of the tub. They didn't even change the water. They picked him up, clothes and all, and put him in the cold tub. And then they fed us. They provided us a place to sleep that night. They cared for us. I remember I tried to communicate with them afterwards, sending them thank you notes. Never got a response. To tell you the truth, I don't even know if they really existed. I don't want to get far out here, but Gurudev was clearly watching us every moment. We were on a mission dedicated to his service. And it was end time if there weren't some miraculous intervention. And there he was, this Good Samaritan. Perfect timing. Either it was incredible synchronicity, serendipity, or it was direct divine intervention. And I don't know if there's a difference between the two, actually. So that's how one of Gurudev's Cadillacs got back here to Virginia. Thank you for this opportunity to share these very precious memories of Sri Gurudev with you. I look forward for future opportunities to do the same. And until then, and always, may peace and joy, love and light be with you. Om Shanti, Shanti, Shanti. Jai Gurudev.